morning, members of the jury and ladies and gentlemen. Today the topic of my presentation is legal education in Sri Lanka and its contribution to legal culture. Along with the head title of legal education of South Asia and its opportunities and challenges, I would like to talk about the legal education in Sri Lankan context and how it contributes to introducing the ethical legal profession. Although the title is about Sri Lanka, I would say it's identifiable that most of these issues I have stated in my research paper is also applicable to the whole South Asian context. Firstly, I would like to base my research on three aspects which are identifiable in the South Asian context and also in the Sri Lankan context. Firstly, I will be speaking about the mismatch between current legal ethics and the legal profession. So in this case, we see in the importance of legal professionalism is that they are prominent actors in the process of ensuring individual rights. We need individual rights in ensuring democracy, constitutionalism, rule of law within a country. Therefore, we see in order to achieve these aspirations, we need to have ethics as a major component in the legal curriculum. I would like to consider USA in this situation and compare that with the whole South Asian context. USA in 1908, they have stated, they have lined up ethics for the lawyers in the Bar Association. In the Sri Lankan context, Article 136G of the Sri Lankan Constitution includes admission, enrollment, suspension and removal of attorneys at law and the legal professions. Although it is stated in the constitutions and the rules of Bar Association, we see that there are many loopholes within the ethics, system and when it includes to the legal profession. For example, if we take lawyers and judges have the respect towards the court, we see within the Sri Lankan context, we have many political motivations in appointing judges. Also, it has been affected by many political considerations of the politicians, and the independence of the judiciary has been vanished, but it has been now regained in a very considerable respect. Also, there are instances where judges, in Sri Lankan context, where judges take bribes. Judges are supposed to be independent to ensure individual rights of people, like disregarding their social class or any monetary compensation they get. But the sad situation is, still within the Sri Lankan context, we have instances where judges taking bribes, and therefore it has been a threat in achieving democracy and individual rights of people. Also, the other important ethic that I would like to consider is the loyalty and concentration about the monetary benefits for a lawyer. We see legal profession or law is supposed to be justifiable. You can't consider about a person's income or the person's social status in ensuring justice. But there are lawyers who mainly concern about the fees they get. Therefore, there are many low income level individuals who get deprived of proper legal representation in their lives. For example, in Sri Lankan context, there are many domestic violence cases and maintenance cases where people suffer without proper legal representation. The second issue I would like to concentrate and talk about is the language problem in the Sri Lankan context. This language problem is highly prevalent in Sri Lankan context, and also I believe this should be highly prevalent in the South Asian context too. What I mean by the language problem is the lack of English knowledge of Sri Lankan law students have deprived them of many job opportunities. We have many talented students in our universities, but they can't go beyond practicing in district courts because appellate courts and supreme courts do function in English. Therefore, their inability to speak proper English would deprive of them from many opportunities. Also, this has resulted in many of the other repercussions. As student politics, this has been a major threat within the Sri Lankan universities. Students who think the lack of English knowledge is a lower privileged ideology, they tend to make conflicts with other students, and the ultimate goal of legal education could not be achieved. Also, earlier, is English English language is considered to be some kind of a measurement that's showing class and or your social status. But today, ladies and gentlemen, we see that English language has become a necessity and a common factor that everybody needs to have in their lives. The third factor I would like to concentrate is that balancing between theory of law and practice of law. We see, we categorize law schools as elite schools mostly on the basis of theory of law. Just because they teach you a lot of theory doesn't mean that it will make you a good professional, a good legal professional. In a research conducted by the Minister of Justice, a sentencing research conducted by the Minister of Justice Sri Lanka shows that judicial discretion of the judges is very high, therefore they give many disproportionate sentences. This is because they are not aware of the practical legal, practical reality for the grassroots levels of the society. Since they don't know the moral considerations, according to the jurisprudential basis of Fuller, we see that law and morality cannot be separated and they should be included together. Therefore, I'd like to conclude my speech saying that we need to concentrate on these three main arguments in order to make a professional or balanced legal profession. Thank you very much.
Question, you know, in page 14 of your written presentation, I find that you make, you want us to make a distinction between professional law school and academic law departments. And any reform in legal education, this should be an approach, because the professional law school will have more skill-oriented, research-based education than an academic law department. It's a point which you have not presented. But I'd like you to comment on it if you like, but very quickly.
Thank you very much for your question, sir. So in case of academic law schools and professional law schools, what we see is that academics, we are mainly concerned about mostly the theoretical basis of law other than for the profession. As I stated earlier, unless you don't have your practical knowledge, you can't understand the legal practical reality in the society or the grassroots levels of the society. So that would help in ensuring justice to individuals other than just including theoretical phrases into judgments. Therefore, judges and practitioners, judges and lawyers both have to have practical knowledge along with theoretical knowledge in order to ensure proper justice to everybody.
Do you all agree that we need in the reform process of legal education, we must divide legal education into two distinct parts? One is concerning the academic theoretical approach to legal education. The other is more skill-oriented, research-based approach to legal education. Now, one is professional, the other is liberal education in law. If that is recommended as a policy approach in reforming legal education, you will be dividing the law schools into two categories. Lot of Indians,
we need to make a bridge between both theory and
practice. You know, you may allow probably the people who have come through the academic stream with certain additional qualifications go into the professional stream, so that the professional stream is not closed for them.
Yes.
But if you don't separate, then the practical, you know, you can't make everybody practice skilled in every aspect of the legal profession. So this is one strategy which appears to be presented by the...
It is a very common criticism that legal academics doesn't understand the grassroots levels of the society.
Okay.
It will be good, but how much, you know, the problem is we have thousands of students. And to be able to have, you have hundreds of law teachers, you have to have. So the problem in financial and management aspects, the solution is...
Can I add one more point, sir?
Uh-huh.
This is where legal clinics come into play, because I don't think any of the South Asian countries, or especially Sri Lanka, we do not require like required number of legal clinical hours in our curriculum. So we don't really get the practical exposure. The court exposure. Therefore, in countries like USA, like England, they have like necessary legal clinical hours in order to complete their curriculum. Therefore, we need policy reforms like that in order to bridge between the two.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Esteemed panel of judges, ladies and gentlemen, a very good morning to you all. I am presenting as a researcher for the Team 6. The topic on which I have done my research is legal education and regional cooperation. Let me present the structure of my research. In this research, firstly, the overview of legal education system, is discussed. Secondly, the contribution made to the regional cooperation in legal education by each of the sub-countries is analyzed. It is important to determine what are the regional measures presently undertaken collectively by sub-countries as a region. A comparative study is made on the other regions in the world such as European Union and ASEAN organization. Finally, the opportunities and challenges facing the South Asian countries in achieving the regional cooperation in legal education is elaborated, and the need of a uniform legal education to achieve much more overall regional integration in terms of the legal system is emphasized. Ladies and gentlemen, South Asian region is unique around the world with its shared religious and cultural heritage with similar political history. Surprisingly, the legal systems of those countries have divergent aspects, varying from country to country. Even though there are differences in legal system, the legal education remains the same as the colonials who were mainly British has first introduced educational standards following the British education system. Globalization had made changes in the education system as well as the legal system in those countries. Regionalism has become a new trend in the world politics. Even though South region accepted this new trend and cooperated in economic and cultural sectors, legal education has been left out of any significant development. Ladies and gentlemen, in this research, to formulate the legal education in sub-countries, literature will have been done in educational policy frameworks and statutes related to the higher education in sub-countries. Moreover, scholarly articles of eminent legal educationalists and professionals have also been considered. When analyzing the different legal education systems in the sub-countries, it can be concluded that the cooperation among scholars and educational institutes are at a minimum. Even though there are students from SAARC countries learning law in prominent regional institutions in the region, their interaction in learning law in a regional consensus is virtually non-existent. As a region, several attempts have been made for the regional cooperation. Establishments of the South Asian Association for Regional Cooperation in Law, or SAARC Law, have attempted to formulate a regional legal body and to expand the current sources of law. The main problem of those regional initiatives is that they hardly go from a drawing board to practical problems in implementation within the SAARC region. Ladies and gentlemen, in comparison to the SAARC region, Europe has developed a comprehensive system of law for decades. They have formulated a unique economic policy, administrative apparatus, and most importantly, a legal system. In 1999, they have initiated the European Educational Integration Policy called Bologna Process. It calls for a European higher education area to streamline the qualification awarding process, unify quality assurance standards, and promoting mobility of students across the region. Regardless of the Bologna Declaration being a policy document, not being legally binding, but there are 49 signatory countries to this process showing the dedication of the European community towards uniformity and education. Bologna process acts as a framework to building up sub-regional educational policies, especially among the Southeast European countries who lags behind the Western counterparts in economic and social development. Realizing the contribution of a well-formed legal education for enhancing the rule of law, Southeast European Law School Network, a collaborative network of legal institutions which encourages the researchers and the research and development of the regional legal studies was established. Conditions encouraging the student mobility have led the European students engaging actively with their regional counterparts, and the incentives for researchers directly contribute to the development of the regional legal system. Student exchange programs such as Erasmus program is also played a huge role in enhancing the student mobility. Continuous study and development in European legal system to streamline education has made the legal system in Europe stand strong, even though there are problems in the economic cooperation within that region. Ladies and gentlemen, the Association of Southeast Asian Nations, ASEAN, has started to follow the European model. By the ASEAN Charter, the organization was given a legal personality and cooperation among the countries has been maximized. For the legal education, there are integration projects in the legal system of ASEAN law, and the region has vested a considerable amount of effort in developing the ASEAN jurisprudence. When considering the legal cooperation in regional cooperation in legal education, the SAARC region is still in its infancy. But there is a lot of potential among SAARC countries to adopt progressive educational policies. In this business, mainly two parts have been identified. First is to formulate a regional legal system for SAARC countries in the areas of international law, maritime law, investment and human rights. Then to introduce educational changes incorporating the newly formulated areas of law. The second approach is to build an initiative for a uniform legal education, standards and uniform curriculums of regional areas to promote academic participation in those areas. A unique SAARC regional legal framework can be formulated. From this, I will conclude at the conclusion of this thesis, I have left open the question of choosing the methodology for enhancing the regional cooperation for the policymakers at both national and regional levels to decide. Thank you.
Establish a legal educational system or framework throughout the SAARC. Is it correct? And you compare it with the European Union model as well as ASEAN. But ASEAN is not like SAARC. SAARC is a complete regional cooperative body. And when it comes about law, there is also related to culture. So how do you accept one thing, that we, all the SAARC countries, are common law and we were part of colonial power. Except that one common thing, how do you answer to the cultural hegemony and differences in promoting this legal education or framework throughout the SAARC?
Thank you for one question. Let me answer this question in two ways. First thing, I have formulated the differences between the ASEAN region and the SAARC region, because we are not copy-pasting what the ASEAN region or the European system into the SAARC region. We have different cultures and the different religious factors are also incorporated. But the thing is, there are some common framework where we can start the building. For example, the maritime law. We don't have a SAARC regional consensus on the maritime law. Or the human rights. Human rights is universal, but we can have a separate regional framework. The SAARC, the human rights initiative for ASEAN. And for the economics, commercial law, as well as information technology. Those areas are common to every region. And with the SAARC region, we can integrate then those regional areas very easily into that region. So we have start building the regional consensus from those type of regional factors, legal factors. Then we can think whether we can incorporate the whole SAARC region into one legal system, or we can left out some legal factors such as customary law in SAARC region. There are vast differences in customary law as well. So but we are not proposing to make the fully integrate the SAARC region in the legal sense. I think I don't answer your question.
Can I have a small question?
Yes, sir.
Do you think, how far do you think the Bologna
process can be a parallel the SAARC context, because the Bologna process, having in mind the European Union, is essentially a unified market with all the problems with the European Union continuing to face today. A unified market can produce a unified, or a near unified legal system and a legal education in demand at all. But we don't have a Bologna process in the SAARC region. For unless we have a SAARC understanding for a unified market and a unified system of law following therefrom, then comes the question of a unified legal system or education. Do you think that there can be a parallel between these two?
Yes, sir. Thank you for the question. I think let me answer you like this. There are two approaches. Firstly, of course, we can let the policymakers or politicians or regional organizations to build the SAARC, like uniform, integrate SAARC more closely like Europe. But that, I don't think that it will happen in this recent decision parliament decade. But there are some elements in the Bologna process we can incorporate into SAARC region. For example, there are like incentives for researchers. And there are quality assurance, uniform quality assurance measures. For example, in the awarding of the degrees. In Sri Lanka, of course, we have 4-year degree, legal degree, and as well as 3-year degree. And sometimes legal postgraduate programs also differ. So even in some other countries, there are differentiations. So, of course, we can't fully integrate, fully copy-paste the Bologna process, but we can take some initiatives such as the curriculum development, some part of the curriculum development. For example, we can build a SAARC curriculum for that. For SAARC, we can a legal service curriculum. And for example, there's a student mobility. In Europe, they have a concept called borderless Europe. Of course, now we can meet the present social situations and security situations. We can't just make in the SAARC region, we can't make a borderless SAARC region. But at least for the students, we can make some important.
Sorry, just one more question.
Yes.
I think I'm still a bit confused about the Bologna process. You see, Bologna process is there to recognize each other's qualification. They don't have a single legal system within the European Union. Yes, there is a European Union law which is applicable in other countries, but they're all unique legal systems. For example, in England and Wales, they've got a common law system like here, whereas the rest of Europe is based on civil law system. So the legal system is completely different.
Yes.
You know, but the question is that, because the SAARC countries are different, how can we sort of embed those differences in developing the curriculum? And will it be able to be possible to have a unified legal system in the SAARC? Which sort of, whether it will work is a question.
Ma'am, I think there are several stages in developing the legal system. For example, there are two differences between the legal system and legal education system. So I don't think that the uniform legal system can be developing in another coming decade. But if you develop the regional legal education system, that may eventually set up the differences and create a unified legal system in the meantime. So I might not like completely changing the legal education system or the legal system in India, but there are some areas which can be incorporated into some region.
Thank you. The next speaker is Pragya Singh. You speak two names from the
A very fine morning to everyone present here. With due respect to dignitaries on the dais and off the dais, I would like to begin my presentation on the paper titled Legal Education in SAARC Countries, Transcending Formidable Boundaries. The hypothesis of my paper is enumerating various problems associated with legal curriculum and to dissect them one by one and form a roadmap to eradicate them. Firstly, I would like to throw some light upon the colonial mindset, upon the colonial setup that we have been that we have adopted without much changes, and we are apparently we are exactly languishing in the colonial hangover, as has been said by an Indian jurist, Upendra Bakshi. Now, the problem, the impact of colonial common law and westernization on our education system are that not many changes have been brought about the law that were actually codified and legislated by the colonizers. The most famous example of it can be the IPC, the Indian Penal Code, which was formulated in the year 1860 by Lord Macaulay. Now, till 2016, there have been a handful of changes that have been brought about in the IPC, and they have been brought about in tandem with law is very organic in nature. It cannot be static. So they have been brought about keeping in sync with the needed regulations, with the changing society. But still there is a lot of need to reform these laws. Also, the adoption of laws made by colonizers have paved way and led us to mediocrity. There has not been a creativity, a sense of creativity in the legislations by Indian legislators. Also, the pre-existing system has led our laws has given it a very strict approach, what the colonizers have given it. It is not customized looking at what the Indian society needs. So, my premise, the entire premise is that we are still stuck in the glorious but anachronous past of the British. Now, the object. Also, I would like to throw light on the changes in the curriculum that can be brought about in the SAARC nations. SAARC is the South Asian Integration, South Asian Association for Regional Cooperation among seven nations, which has been joined by Afghanistan in the year 2007. Now, the SAARC nations are culturally quite similar in nature, and they have been the colonies of the British. Therefore, their problems are very much similar. So, they command for a solution which will also be similar, customized to all these nations. We are rich in our cultural heritage. We are rich in our social aspects, and more or less our economies also fall at the same platter. So the solutions will also be same. We can use our culture in such a way, and we can integrate ourselves in such a way so as to foster a sense of cooperation, a sense of brotherhood in the legal fraternity amongst the budding lawyers that we are producing. Now, I would like to analyze this whole problem of bringing about the change in the curriculum on the basis of as a law student, stepping into the shoes of a law student. The problems which I face and which my peers face on an everyday basis. Law is being taught in every law school in a very traditional and in a very cliche manner. Like, the subjects which we have are more or less the same. The 5 years integrated course which we have are more or less the same. But what lacks is the exploring laws beyond the black letters of law. This can be inculcated only through practical exposure, which can be brought about through efforts of students and law schools collectively. For example, moot court program, internship trainings, these have been inculcated compulsorily, not compulsorily, but in a part of our curriculum. But still, there are a lot of students who do not participate in them, and there are a lot of students who do not have a deeper insight into the subject matters we actually discuss. For example, I would like to the same moot court which we did for the national rounds. We researched upon right to privacy. The entire theme of the program was right to privacy. Now, researching on such a topic extensively gave me and all my co-participants a deeper insight to which was actually deprived by my colleagues back in the law school. So, what our education system faces the problem? It essentially faces the problem of lack of exploration of fields. And also, it has law has been made a very business. It has been converted into a business. And once you graduate, most of the people undertake corporate jobs, litigations, NGOs. But as such, on the research front, there is a lot of lacking on the research. I like to just quote an example that in our law school currently there has been a revision of the curriculum plan for the fourth year students, and our dean specifically made training programs like litigation training, NGO training, corporate training. But she said that I'm not putting research because there are not many takers of that particular program. So it does reflect that people are not ready to go into research and have a deeper insight into these areas which otherwise go unexplored by students. And in the end, I would just like to quote that in the World Economic Forum, there has been a report published by them which enlists 10 important guidelines, which enlists 10 important traits in order to learn law and how one can enjoy law. So one of the most important traits is that we fail to inculcate a sense of the art of learning law and actually living law, loving law, because that is how we can not be produced as half-baked lawyers, but as a proper, as a holistic law, legal profession by the end of our courses. Thank you.
You mentioned somewhere in your paper that we need to develop Asian law schools with international partners.
Indeed, sir.
This is in page, you have not page number 10.
Yes, sir. It's there on the intra-regional collaboration and inter-government initiatives. Yes, sir. Actually, due to paucity of time, I could not touch upon this, but it is very important that we secure cooperation from these SAARC regions, because as I mentioned in my speech, that our problems are similar, therefore the solutions can also be similar. So, like the ASEAN, they have deliberated upon establishing ASEAN law schools and having a uniform curricula to them. So similarly, we can seek help from our SAARC partners and have international law schools, international internship programs. Now, international internship programs happens to be a very expensive affair. So for this, we can seek scholarships. We can seek financial aid from corporate law firms, then governmental, non-governmental institutions. Because at the end of the day, the aim should not be simply producing a lawyer and graduating a person with a law degree. It should be producing a social engineer who can actually connect with the society. Because law is the society. Because law is connecting with the society. Law is having an insight, having a perception for the society. That is what should be our approach, and that is what I personally believe in.
I have some question. It's more of a problem. The way we look at research, legal research, and you reflect some of the issues. The assumption is that the colonial past is so deadly and evil, a congenital defect. We must get ourselves free from that, right? Now, I do not know how many penal codes of other countries you have studied to condemn the Indian penal code. Because when you talk of legal reforms, legal research, legal education, they are also related, right? Now, when you talk of common legal education approaches in our countries, is it just sufficient to condemn colonial legal system and colonial legal education? And we have the problems of diversity of our own traditions, religious and other aspects in the SAARC countries. So I do not know whether it is maybe the colonial part which is a problem, but some other aspects of our part equally a problem. Because equally a problem, we are not getting anywhere by merely condemning colonial past. Firstly, some scholars have studied the Indian, since you talk about the Indian Penal Code, some scholars have studied the Indian Penal Code and the Commonwealth Penal Code, and they have said the Indian Penal Code is like heaven compared to the disorderliness in the Penal Code of the Commonwealth countries. So there is a good deal of things to be said in support of the Indian Penal Code. So perhaps unless we are very clear about what we are talking about, condemning colonial past, we're not probably really doing justice to, you know, transforming legal education. I just want to flag this issue so that we are clear about it.
Thank you for the question, sir. Sir, I personally do not mean to condemn the British colonial system in toto. I just mean to say that we are still languishing in the colonial hangover, because not many reforms and not many changes have been brought about in the law which have been given to us by them. And looking at the pace at which the society changes and the need to bring about these changes is still very less. And the premise of my research paper is not just condemning it, but seeking and fostering a sense of cooperation amongst the SAARC nations, so that we don't have to be much dependent upon the Western education system. We can have an indigenously built education system within the cooperation sought from the SAARC nations, which will help us become an empowered lot, because we constitute almost one third of the global populace. So if we strengthen ourselves, we need not be much dependent upon the Western systems. So blaming them is not what I say. I say we can have something of ours so that we are not dependent upon them in the
I am not asking you to be defensive, I am saying something else.
No, sir.
In the sense that, look at, for instance, the English people really understood the needs, let's say, of some of the SAARC regions where they were colonial masters. Let's look at the high courts which were established way back in 1860, the procedural courts of a country, the reforms in Hindu law, the reforms in land revenue, the reforms in land legislation, and the breaking of the Paragraph of the Constitution adopted, almost all the countries have experimented on land reform legislations. So we have broken away from in the colonial past in significantly. But when you look at what happens in Australia, New Zealand, or some of the commonwealth relating to the procedural laws and the court systems, the adversarial system. So the adversarial system is something which is a colonial past, let us say. Have we broken away from it? Have the commonwealth countries have been able to break away from it? So that we look at legal education, two important components. The substantive legal content of legislations and administration of justice. So administration, this is closely related to how we actually apply the law, implement the law, and be able to deliver justice to the, you know, to the people. So the systems of courts. So do we have a common system of courts in our country? Can we have? Can we have a common procedural law? Can we have some kind of improvements on ensuring that we give up the adversarial legal system and shift some other legal system, administration justice? Here are some of the questions.
Sir, it's a very novel idea, and it is a very innovative idea that that we can have a system of our own and to just do away with the colonial whatever has been given to us by the colonizers. Sir, for that, and this seems very pragmatic also, because we face a similar set of problems. Therefore, the solutions can also be seen. And sir, at the end of the day, it rests with the law students, which are the budding lawyers. And this can be instilled with a sense of better understanding, having a deeper insight into the nitty-gritties of law. For example, the Article 14 of the Indian Constitution. It says equality before law and equal procedure of law. Now, there are a lot of students who do not understand that there is an inherent difference between the two. This can be only dealt with and this can be only understood through through exploring it and exploiting it totally in and out. Left, right and center analysis of a particular thing has to be done. So,
thank you.